Morning to all of you. Thank you very much for coming for this Shrenik Lalbhai chair lecture, which is delivered by Professor Howard Spodek, who's Shrenik Lalbhai chair of management of social organizations here at Ahmedabad University, as well as a professor of history at Temple University. Most people here know, I'm sure, know Howard in a variety of different ways. he probably has studied Ahmedabad longer than anyone else in this room. And there are three things about him that one can, when I can at least vouch for that I've known him for a short period of time. One is his immense resourcefulness, which leads to comprehensiveness. The kind of work that he does ties in perspectives from a variety of different domains and a variety of different directions, which is not very easy to do. Sometimes our own positions, intellectual or otherwise, stand in the way of creating this phenomenal comprehensiveness. But Howard is one of those very rare people who's been able to kind of transcend that boundary. The second is immense persistence. I mean, somebody who stays and studies Ahmedabad for 40 plus years has to be immensely persistent. and that persistence leads to to deep depth of understanding of both the dynamics of how a city, as well as people function, but at the same time also how he's one of those very few people who have also seen it change over a long period of time. And third, he's immense votary for liberal education and support for Ahmedabad University. And all three of them endear us to him very, very deeply. I don't want to tell you about his degrees because they all come from great institutions ranging from an undergrad at Columbia to master's and PhD at Chicago. He's done several books on Ahmedabad. He's made films which have captured the immense diversity of both activities as well as social dynamics. So it is such a pleasure to have you back here, Howard, and to have you deliver the Shrenik Lalbhai Chair lecture today. So please.
Thank you for inviting me. Thank you all for coming. Thank this array and army of people who have helped me set all of this up. And I hope that what I say will make it worthwhile for you. It is always a pleasure to come back to Ahmedabad, and I always learn so much from meeting new people and seeing new things and meeting old people, or at least old friends, and meeting with them and finding out what's going on. I'll talk today about the city of Ahmedabad, which is really the subject of almost all of my main research. And some of the issues that I'm looking at right now and some of the issues that seem to me to be important that other people are also looking at. I wanted to begin with a sense of framing what I want to talk about. And I want to talk about perspectives and values. I want to talk about change over time and the particulars. And I want to talk a little bit about Ahmedabad's place in the world. I'm trained as a historian, and I think as a historian, thinking about before and after, cause and effect, relationship of events one to the other. And sometimes I run across people, including my own students in Philadelphia, who don't think that way, and it always surprises me. They don't see the connection between things that I seem to see. So I wanted to talk about these habits of the mind of historians and how they fit with the city of Ahmedabad, even for people who are not historians. I wanted to begin by reading a little bit from Amruta's Shah. Basically, I want to also introduce some books that and articles that have been written within the past 2 or 3 years, and to look at some materials that are in process that are not yet published, and some of them are not yet translated. You would think from Gujarati to English or English to Gujarati, but actually from French to either English or Gujarati. I wanted to begin with a reading from Amrita Shah, from her new book. Many of you will be familiar with it, a very peculiar title, Ahmedabad, A City in the World. Where else? But in any case, She interviews a number of people in Ahmedabad. She does almost, I used to say vignettes, but actually they're more snapshots, very brief interviews with people, except for one or two. And there's one major character in her book named Miraj. He's a man who lives in Chamanpura, Sarva Chamanpura, a Muslim who is burned out by mobs in 2002 and flees to Bombay Hotel. I want to read a little bit about him. I heard of, and then there was Miraj. I met him while visiting a unit of Sanchetna, a non-governmental organization working on health and education issues among the underprivileged. Let me go on. I actually want to go a page on from that. As the orders, she talks about his success as a businessman, as a weaver and a promoter of weaving, of commercial weaving. As the orders mounted, he bought more machines and hired workers. His workshop bristled with reams of cotton, polyester, and pashmina, saris, and kaftans. The orders were getting so voluminous he was thinking of buying a second-hand Maruti van. By then, he had 3 small children, and a car would have been useful for family outings as well. But he hesitated. It was not his way to give in to momentary impulses. His priority was to expand the business if the money would be better spent on buying machinery and hiring workers. It was the typically Ahmedabad way to suppress present gratification for future growth. On February 28, 2002, a mob of Hindu militants had burst in and destroyed everything he owned. Household conveniences, vehicles, machinery. Chah, he lamented, chah, still incredulous. 6 years later, at the manner in which the rioters, with their wanton destructiveness, had rendered his pragmatism impractical and foolish. So he's a man whose whole life, his material life, has been destroyed. And he goes to Bombay Hotel. And when she interviews him again, toward the very end of the book, he has gone on a visit to UP, to Uttar Pradesh, where his original family lives. And he's come back from that visit, and on the almost the very last few pages of the book, Amrita Shah asks him, would you leave Ahmedabad? And he says, in that village, there was no road till recently, and electricity only for a few hours. There are no shops. You would have to walk 4 kilometers to find a restaurant, so you have to eat whatever is given and however much. It's very pretty, very green, with a river in the middle. But when we go, we want to leave soon because it is boring there. We have become used to the pleasures of the city. Who would want to leave Ahmedabad? And I thought, that what a great ending that would be for this book. Here is a man who has suffered, who has begun to rebuild his life, but has lost a great deal because of situations in Ahmedabad, and yet says at the end, who would want to leave Ahmedabad? What is surprising to me about this book is that Amrita Shah doesn't end there. She ends 3 or 4 pages later. She adds what she calls a coda to the book, and in that coda, she sets it on Makar Sankranti, just about this time of year. And there's a young boy who's chasing a kite. And the kite keeps eluding him, and finally it falls to the ground. The paper has all but come away from the light wooden frame. He tugs, trying again to raise it. It hops like a man on a pogo stick, then splat on the road. A car goes over it. He reels it in, shredded, autumnal thing. And I said to myself, as I read to the end of the book, why did she choose this second ending that really comes out of nowhere? instead of the first ending, what I saw as an ending, just three or four pages before, which really picks up, it bookends the book. It begins with Miraj, it ends with him. I don't know why, but the point that that struck me is when you do a study of anything, and especially a city, you need a point of view. And it had struck me that she had a point of view, which was the city, for all of its problems, was a place that even those who had suffered would not want to leave. But she doesn't leave it there, and I'm not sure why. She leaves with a somewhat dispirited ending, a kid trying to chase a kite. The kite gets, you know, run over by traffic, and it's finished. I don't know why. But this question of perspective is really important. And I want to pick that up also in another book, Esther David's recent book on Ahmedabad, City with a Past. One book is City in the World, the other book is City with a Past. These are, I think, peculiar names, but in any case, this one less so. I want to read what she writes, because she's beginning to pick out issues in Ahmedabad that she doesn't herself study, but they are worth studying. And she, let me just read it rather than talk on about it. She says, these mill owners are still synonymous with Ahmedabad's cultural heritage. Some were philanthropists who donated large amounts in the creation of major educational institutes, like this one, and invited the world's greatest architects to the city, giving us the great architectural marvels of Le Corbusier and Louis Kahn. Old money people have almost always been mill owners, but after the 1984 mill workers' strike in Mumbai, most mills closed down there and in Ahmedabad. During this time, weaving factories and printing houses mushroomed in Gujarat, making a further dent in the textile industry of Ahmedabad. And then she goes on. The boom of industry, there's new industry in Ahmedabad, of course, pharmaceuticals and the like, chemicals. The boom of industry in Ahmedabad has created a new breed known as new money. Their lifestyle is different, as most have foreign collaborators, even if it's an animal health foundation, a non-governmental organization, an NGO with links abroad. At new money parties, French, German, or Dutch is often heard, and in many families, it's a matter of pride to have a foreign bride from America or another Western country. So here, Esther, in her own way, is pointing out a social difference in the city that I don't know. Many of these subjects that I come across, I haven't myself had time to research, and I'm not always sure if people have researched them, but she poses a very interesting idea about the various groups in the city and what their basis of wealth is and how it affects them. Did I want to read a little bit more from here? Let me leave it at that. But here again, we have not really a study of Ahmedabad, but an approach to understanding the city that is quite interesting. As you read the entire book, it's pretty clear that Esther's sympathies, her interest lies with old money. She spends a lot of her book going around the city, pointing out elements in the city. It's a wonderful book to go with historic preservation, because she cites so many places that that are worthy and are in fact the subject of historic preservation. And she seems allied with that group. She opens the book with a description of what she calls a Zen bungalow, kind of a glass house that is over the top in luxury and modernity, and it's pretty obvious that she doesn't like it very much. So again, if you're going to study the city, you need a sense of perspective of where do you begin, and we've heard some from Amrita, and we've heard some from Esther. I want to learn to look also at a book by a woman named Ipshita Chatterjee. She is from the name Bengali, but she lives and works in Texas. I have not met her personally. And she talks about the displacement of people from the riverfront. And it's really, let me read to you a little bit about her point of view of how to understand the city and what is worth looking at. And she talks about something called the right to the city. Let me pause for a minute to talk about that. This phrase, right to the city, has been used increasingly by advocates for poor people, for marginalized people, for people who don't have a right to the city. That is, either they don't have money and can't participate, or they are of a minority group which is not welcome to participate, and oftentimes they don't feel welcome to participate because the culture of the place they're visiting is of people who are richer and more refined than they are. And there are many academics and many advocates who talk about claiming the right to the city for the dispossessed. She says, the right to the city is a promising catchphrase, but it sediments heterogeneous, she's an academic, unlike the two people we've looked at till now, is a promising catchphrase, but it is a sediment, but it sediments heterogeneous layers of actors, their aspirations and their demands. It includes those who are dispossessed, those who are dispossessing them, and various other participants who are some combinations of these. A radical analysis, however, must concern itself with those who do not have the right to the city, or the right to control the urban process by imagining it, participating in it, and appropriating it. In the case of Ahmedabad, therefore, it is the right of slum dwellers of the Sabarmati that should concern us, and not the right of the Sabarmati Riverfront Development Corporation, the AMC, the corporate builders, or global capital. So she is seizing, she understands that anyone can claim the right to the city. Anyone, I mean, it's my city, it's your city, it's everybody's city. But she says some people feel dispossessed, and it's her job as an academic, but an advocate, to argue on their behalf. It's a very interesting position, and we all know, I suppose we all know, many people in the city of Ahmedabad who take that position. They argue on behalf of the dispossessed and their right to the city. But she recognizes, as we're looking at perspectives, she recognizes that that's not the only way to look. And she cites Bimal Patel as a person who tries, as a planner, to straddle the various groups in the city and bring them all to the table. Bimal Patel and organizations like his straddle the twilight zones between the hardened institutional structures of accumulation, like the AMC and the Chamber of Commerce on the one hand, and civil society groups like NGOs and social movements on the other, because they claim that both institutional entrepreneurialism and people's demands can be balanced if the opposing parties are brought to the table for effective communication. And so she stands firmly on the side of working for the dispossessed, but she recognizes that there are at least some people who say a city has to be balanced. And if you're going to do effective city planning, you cannot simply stand with one group against the others. You really have to, or at least should, listen to the various voices that are working together and to negotiate among them. So you need to be inclusive. While you need to be attentive to growth, you also need to be attentive to distribution. All of these readings that I've looked at with you are talking about the need to find values in working with the city and in understanding the people who write about it. It's one of the challenges that I personally in my research face all the time, because it is my job to talk to people on all sides. That's my job in the sense of, if I want to understand the city, I really have to talk to the poor and the rich and the Hindus and the Muslims and the Parsis and the Christians and the Sikhs. That's the way you understand the city, and the people who live on the east side and the people who live on the west side. But the views that I hear in my conversation are often so different from one another that they're always so different from one another that it really challenges my sense of how to understand and write about the city. I want to share with you parts of a film that we made a few years ago in 2010-11. If it comes up, yes, here we go. I'll share parts of it with you, and you'll see how these issues come up. Ahmedabad is India's seventh largest city, with a population of about 6 million people. It's 300 miles north of Bombay. It's known as a rich city, but about a fourth of its population live in poverty.
No Ahmedabadi could walk along the length of the river. Okay? We have taken the entire riverfront from all the rich people, and indeed also the slums that were there, and turned it into something that the city as a whole can access. This river now becomes accessible to everybody in the city.
The families living along the Sabarmati River are squatters. They have no legal claim to the property they live on.
એ અમારા હાથમાં નથી, તેના માટે જજ પછી કમિટીના મેમ્બરો ને બધા બેસશે.
પીપલ હેવ અ રાઇટ ટુ નો એન્ડ ટુ બી ઇન્ફોર્મડ અબાઉટ ધી નેચર ઓફ ધ પ્રોજેક્ટ એન્ડ ઇટ્સ ઇમ્પેક્ટ અપોન ધ પીપલ.
ગિરીશ પટેલ ઇઝ અમદાવાદ્સ લીડિંગ પબ્લિક ઇન્ટરેસ્ટ લોયર. હી રિપ્રેઝેન્ટ્સ રેઝિડન્ટ્સ હુઝ ક્લેમ્સ ટુ ન્યુ હાઉસિંગ વર ડિનાઇડ.
એકોર્ડિંગ ટુ અવર એસ્ટિમેટ ધેર આર મોર ધેન 15,000 to 20,000 ફેમિલીઝ who are likely to be affected by this project. According to them, you know, there are only about 8,000 families. Some will be covered by the project, some may not be covered. So where do you draw the line? We claim that we must have a right to rehabilitation. The court admitted the petition and granted a stay that these people are not to be displaced unless and until they are properly rehabilitated. If we had not filed the petition, some people would have been rehabilitated, others would have been driven away, and nothing would happen. At least, you know, one good feature of the petition is that because of the petition and the stay order, the problems of these people are required to be taken notice of by the corporation, and corporation is answerable to the court, and that's how it ensures that at least they will get houses.
So, वहाँ से तुम जो जा रहे हो.
Deja de hablar los ojos. ¡Hola, Resina!
They don't have a choice as to which properties they go to. They're allocated by lottery. Financially, they'll pay monthly payments over the next 10 years. At the end of the 10 years, they will own it. It will be theirs. They will have legal title.
There are a number of issues in this film that are worth discussing and worth researching and worth a direction of study. And I want to call to your attention some that I see here as the film unfolds. One is the very brief meeting or encounter with a woman in the slum who says Hindus and Muslims live here together. This was a slum underneath the Nehru Bridge, nearby Nehru Bridge. Hindus and Muslims live here together, and we get along just fine. And in fact, that was, to my knowledge, true. What happened when people moved was the housing was allocated by lottery. The idea was if you allocate by lottery, there's no room for corruption. There's no room for people to seize things that they shouldn't get. But at the same time, it meant that these communities, these neighborhoods were broken up. And people in the neighborhood said, look, I'm a Hindu living among Muslims. I know these people. They are my friends. I've lived here for years. That's fine. But if you move me to another place with Muslims that I don't know, I'm going to be very ill at ease. This is not a city where that is safe. And the same, of course, the reverse for Muslims, saying that I'm fine with Hindus here. I know them. They're my neighbors. But if you move me elsewhere, to new people, I'm not so comfortable. So that the move from the riverfront actually increased the communal segregation in the city. Second is the nice section there with Girish Patel talks about the rule of law and the fact that people always had a claim to go to law, to the law court, to claim the right to the city. They might get it, might not get it, but they had the right to do that. I'll come back to that, I think, in a few minutes. The drive going from the area under the bridge out to the Ajit Mill complex gives you a sense of the distance that they travel. I think it's about 7 kilometers, as I remember. And that creates enormous problems for the people who are moved because it separates them from their workplace and it separates them from their community. And that's always raised as one of the big problems with these kinds of moves. There, of course, the quality of the housing that they go to is better, but the separation from community and from jobs is important, is really critical. There is no consultation. And of all the issues that we look at here, and the issues that we saw in Ipshita's book also, the Chatterjee book where she talks with Bimal, the notion is that there isn't any consultation. And I thought about that in my own life. If someone moved me without my, you know, asking me to another house, a better house, 5 miles from where I lived, I wouldn't like it. Even if the house was really nice and even if the neighborhood was really nice, if I wasn't consulted, I wouldn't like it very much. And these people aren't consulted at all. You could see when the city officials come, they say, you pack up tomorrow morning, you're moving. They knew that was coming. That wasn't completely out of the blue, but they didn't know exactly when, and they certainly were not consulted. And the housing that they got was by lottery. The monthly payments is much more problematic than this film suggests. It turns out that oftentimes the monthly payments are not collected for political reasons as well as others, but mostly political reasons. People are told no one will ever evict you even if you don't pay. But that leaves people in limbo. If they pay, they're out the money. But if they don't pay, they don't get property contracts. They don't get deeds. So the issue is problematic, and I've talked to a number of people who deal in low-income housing and housing for the poor, and that is a very common pattern apparently across India, that people are given low-income housing, they're told to pay, the money isn't collected, they don't pay it, and at the end it isn't clear what happens to them. So there are many issues here that require further study, and I wanted to look at two aspects
is worth of about triple what they'll pay
of the further study that we want here. I want to stop this again. I want to get rid of it. I want to. I want to get rid of all of these things. I don't know how to do it. Does anybody know how to get rid? I think I do know. Just a second. I don't. Okay, that'll do. I want to take you into the slums where they go. This is a few years later. This is 2016. In the Ajit Mill complex to the home of Akbar Bai and Sultana Ben, the couple that and their family that were moved. And this is a visit that I paid to them in, I don't know, maybe July of this year, of last year, of 2016. And I'm just going to take you without too much discussion, this is what the inside of their apartment looks like right now. They claim to be quite happy where they are for a variety of reasons, some that have to do with the new home and some that have to do with changes in their family. Some of the younger kids who were draws on the family income are now working. So they now have three earners in the family, and that, apart from anything dealing with the change, family change has made a difference in their lives. There you are. Apura went with me to help out here. She isn't usually there. Some of the people say they're doing better, some say they're doing worse, but this is the kind of study that's necessary if you're really to understand what's going on with this move. That at the moment that people move, everything is obviously disrupted, and they're very generally very unhappy. 3 or 4 years later, they may very well have adjusted and said, listen, we now have middle class, or not, that we now have middle class homes, we have a real apartment, we have new jobs, we found jobs, we figured out how to get to our old jobs, and this is me, and back with the, this is the mother of Akbar Bhai. She's the woman who cried and cried when he left. She lives in Shahpur, and this family is very interesting because unlike many of the families, I like this. She is blessing me, and I have my hand on her leg. I don't know quite what's going on here. But in any case, the family that was moved originally lived in her home. That's his mother. And they lived there until they had their second child 17 years before the move. And at that point, they didn't have space to live in that apartment anymore. That's when they went to the riverfront. So that's one element that I want to share with you. And the other is, what has happened to the riverfront? And here, there were so many stories told in 2010, 2011, when the move was made, saying that the riverfront would be sold out to big private capital. It was part of the neoliberal city, and we soon would see big giant buildings, high skyscrapers along the Sabarmati River that would be owned and run not only by local capital, but by international capital. And that, for the most part, hasn't happened. This was my view. The agreement, the legal agreement, that's not the right word, the plan for the development of the Sabarmati Riverfront was that 15% of the land would be sold, indeed, to private capital, foreign or domestic, and the other 80, in order to pay for the other 85% that would be left for the people. And I went yesterday to the event center to see the flower show. I'm going very quickly because this is going to run forever if I don't. All kinds of exhibits for what can be bought, organic farming techniques. Things from the Van, from the Dongs, fake lions and tigers, and people in basically enjoying themselves. And I must say again, you have to figure out your own point of view when you go to these things. You know, what is your value statement? And on the one hand, I thought, yeah, poor people have been evicted from here, and you don't see. This was in the afternoon. I mean, this is when working people. People who don't have to work at 2 o'clock in the afternoon can go there. And so the crowd is a pretty upper middle class crowd. Behind it is a very large building. And there are the poor people that you see are the ones who are tending the flowers. Ilaben once said to me, Howard, always look at the people doing the hard manual work. They are part of the scene. So this is the guy, and I thought to myself, well, it's true that poor people are not there at this time. I don't know what's the case early in the morning or late at night. It's a free exhibit. If you haven't gone, I commend it to you. It's a really nice place to go. But it's free. There's no bar. It's not Kankaria, where the whole debate came up about the 10 rupee entrance charge. People can come if they want. Poor people are not there. They may not feel comfortable. But there it is. So the second question about the removal from people at the riverfront is, well, what was done with the riverfront? There is a fair amount of literature on the displacement of the poor. who really blocked, I mean, they lived there, so their dwellings blocked entrance for everybody else to using the riverfront. This is one of the uses of the riverfront now, and I think that if one is really investigating the development of a city, you have to look also at what happened on the riverfront. What's there now? And in terms of directions for the study of Ahmedabad, I would commend that to anybody who's, you know, who wants to look further. How is the riverfront being used? I want to say two more things about this. One is that there is a center at across the way there at SEPT called Q, the Center for Urban Equity, that does do studies of the displacement of the poor and publishes, I'm not getting this quite right, and publishes many many papers. The first one here is an early one, Subversive Urban Development in India, Implications on Planning and Education by Darshini Mahadevia. There are people who study the displacement. They tend not to look at the uses of the riverfront later. They tend to be advocates on the other side. I wanted to mention one other thing and then move on. In 2012, in the state elections, low-income housing had not been part of the agenda for Ahmedabad for many years. People did not do low-income housing. The Gujarat Housing Board had basically stopped working, and especially stopped working on low-income housing in the late 1990s, early 2000s. And they stopped for a variety of reasons, but the political leaders were not advocating that. And suddenly, in the election of 2012, the Congress Party said, if we are elected to the government of Gujarat, we will build 20 lakhs of low-income, middle-income, both low- and middle-income housing across Gujarat. In reply, the BJP replied, they'll build 20 lakhs, you elect us, we'll be 50 lakhs. But the point is that a subject that had not been on the public agenda for 10 or even 20 years was suddenly thrust onto the public agenda by a political party and by two political parties that thought that there were votes to be gained by such a program. And of course, when Narendra Modi became the Prime Minister of India, he introduced the PM Avas Yojana, the Prime Minister's Avas Yojana, introducing the idea of low-income housing at the national level. So this is also something that deserves some study. I will get to that a little bit, but probably not too much. But this question of how does the public agenda change in a city? When I say that, I let me digress for just a second. I think of the United States, where I am a citizen and a native-born person, and I think about, you probably have heard about it, we elected a new president who seems to have an agenda quite different from any agenda that has been in place for the last few years. So one asks oneself, how does a new agenda get implanted, and what will happen? But in any case, for the purposes of this talk, we have to look at how new issues are entered into the public agenda. I also wanted to talk about how history changes. Most non-historians, I think, believe that history is a matter of the past. It happened, it's over, and we write about what happened. But the fact is that historians look back at the past to see things that they hadn't seen before, because they're looking through the lens of new issues. That is, new issues arise today, and they say, well, how did that play out in the past? One of the areas that I won't talk about today where that has been very important is in women's history. As women around the world begin to claim more public space for themselves, they begin to look back in the past and say, well, what happened in the past? What was women's roles in the past? Can we draw any information, any inspiration, any ideas from the place of women in the past? This same looking to the past to understand the present in a new way occurs everywhere. And Tommaso Bobbio, who's an Italian scholar, there aren't all that many Italian scholars who come to Ahmedabad, wrote a book called Urbanization, Citizenship, and Conflict in India, Ahmedabad 1900 to 2000. He covers much of the same time period that I wrote about in my own book, Ahmedabad Shock City of 20th Century India, but he looks specifically much more at the laboring and working classes. And he says the path that brought Ahmedabad from becoming an industrial center to growing into a large metropolis in the era of neoliberal India has many analogies. I'm sorry, that, I want to read a little further on. But exploring the dynamics of change in the spatial and socio-cultural milieu of the city since the early phases of its industrial expansion up to the post-industrial transition, this book proposes an investigation into the history of Ahmedabad as a way to think about broader processes that profoundly marked the process of urbanization in 20th century India. In particular, cities grew large mainly from the steady influx of migrants and became a crossroads for a circulation of people, goods, and capital that progressively modified the balance between the rural and the urban. Most migrants settled in the city on a permanent or semi-permanent basis, positioning themselves at the lower edge of the urban social milieu, but many others engaged in circular migration patterns that brought them to move regularly between the city and the countryside in a life of constant exploitation. The rise of a mechanized industry, as well as the improvement of infrastructure and communication, boosted the growth of Ahmedabad, while at the same time accelerating a process that transformed wide areas throughout the city. And he finds instances, the interrelation of dynamics of social, political, and this is of course an academic book, so the writing is turgid and difficult to read a little bit, but that's what we academics, as you know, I mean, you're either one of them or you're working with them. So here we go. The interrelation of dynamics of social, political, and economic change was reflected in the geography of urban development. Instances of social inequality, as well as solidarities and antagonisms among different groups, became inscribed in the organization of housing and the distribution of services over the metropolitan area. So he says, if you look at the past, it isn't just the Kasturbais and the Sarabais and the Ahmedabad Education Society that made Ahmedabad. It was also these migrants who came in and had a very difficult time. And he says, I want to trace the life of what he calls the subalterns, the people toward the bottom of society who came in and had to earn a living. And he said, they haven't been studied enough. And if we really want to understand the process of transformation, we have to look at that as well. I want to add a side comment. I made a trip to China about 1985. I was on my way from India to the United States. Temple University was doing some work in China, and I thought I would connect there briefly. And I wound up talking to a professor at Fudan University in Shanghai. And he said, you study the city. You study the city. He said, you must use the Marxist analyses. And I thought, actually, I don't particularly use Marxist analyses. That's not my perspective. But so many people in the world do use a Marxist perspective for studying the city, the subalterns versus the wealthy classes, the poor versus the rich. Many perspectives on the city are an antagonistic perspective. I myself much more try to get a sense of the various groups that are at work. Finally, I wanted to look at issues of connection between Ahmedabad and the world. The book that I wrote, called Shock City of 20th Century India, made the argument that Ahmedabad was a leader in many respects in India. It was a shock city. It was a place where things happened first. Gandhi led all of India in the freedom struggle, but he made his home in Ahmedabad for 15 years. The modernization of industry and of new institutions like the Ahmedabad Education Society and later the university and SEPT and what have you, these institutions also were, and the IIM and the NID and the PRL and the ATIRA, all of these nationally known institutions were part of that. That was the second stage in which Ahmedabad was a leader in all of India. The third stage was in the pogrom against Muslims that also was a leader in India in how badly people could get along and how violent relations could be between Hindus and Muslims. But Ahmedabad was a leader. And what strikes me is that Ahmedabad remains, if not a leader in terms of the first city to experience change, it is experiencing change along with the rest of the world. And we have to understand what is going on here in terms of what is going on in the rest of the world. And one of the terms that is used a lot is the neoliberal city, which fundamentally means, or the neoliberal economy, an economy that is based on free markets, on the law of supply and demand, where government is made minimal, where people, where labor oftentimes is paid less, where the government does not supply subsidies, the government withdraws itself from the social welfare network for a large extent, where there is an attempt to get FDI, foreign direct investment, where the city emphasizes the growth aspects of the economy, and usually this notion of the neo, and it's usually used negatively, that is to say, usually the people who use the term neoliberal don't like it. They don't like the withdrawal from the government, and they don't like the withdrawal of the social welfare net from the general population. They prefer to think about distribution rather than growth, and that's part of the poles that you get in thinking about cities and the economy generally. Some want growth, and others stress distribution, and of course, I, always trying for the middle, think that you really need both. In any case, this puts Ahmedabad in line with other neoliberal developments around the world, including in the United States, the so-called Los Angeles School, which talks especially about Los Angeles, and the fact that it has a very booming economy for those who participate in it at the highest level, the filmmakers, the airplane builders, I think IT is also there in Los Angeles, certainly is in Silicon Valley to the north. These are the growth sectors of the economy, and the people working there do very well. But the workers often are new immigrants from Mexico, the ones that Mr. Trump wants to build a wall to keep out. They are people from Korea. There are various minority groups that have come to seek low-paying jobs because that's what they can get. And Ahmedabad, with this notion of migrant labor also, is in that same category with the Los Angeles School. It is one of the world cities that deals in this neoliberal development and a question of how far it should or should not go. The person who is writing about this the most, to my knowledge, that touches on Ahmedabad is Christophe Jaffrelot, who writes about twice a month in the Indian Express, and writes about, he's been writing a lot about the lack of jobs. I don't know whether you follow this. The whole Patidar Andolan, the whole Patidar agitation, was an agitation that said, yes, yes, industry is growing, and if you own that industry, you do very well, but if you're a worker, you can't find a job. So that is also an area for a new direction for the study of Ahmedabad, and there are people working on that. Another area that puts Ahmedabad into global focus is the work of a woman named Sanjeevani Lokande in her book Communal Violence, Forced Migration and the State, Gujarat since 2002, and she's interested in what has happened legally to the people who were displaced in 2002. The issue is this, and it is also a global issue, and really it is a global issue. Traditionally, if people are refugees from their country and leave, they flee their country and go somewhere else, we see it now in Syria especially, millions of people leaving the country, they are refugees and they are subject to international laws and consideration subject to refugees. But what is the status of people who are removed from their homes but stay in the same country? They are not international refugees. They are refugees, but not international refugees. What is their status? And that issue has come up in Ahmedabad with the people who are dislocated by 2002. The question is, to what degree do they have a claim on government assistance because they are IDPs, internally displaced people? That's the term, IDP, internally displaced people. And Sanjeevani writes about this get the exact paragraph that I wanted here. The Indian justice, I'll cut to the last sentences. The Indian justice system is yet to appreciate and incorporate international normative development against violence against groups, such as the United Nations Convention Against Torture, the United Nations Guiding Principles on Internally Displaced Persons, and UN Principles on Remedy and Reparation. What she's actually calling for here, what she's asking about here, is to what degree should external countries be involved if there are pogroms and what happens to the people afterward. She points out that in Ahmedabad and in Gujarat, the government said these people who are now living in Jaipura and Bombay Hotel, I mean, I should be more specific, they're living in many in Jaipura and Bombay Hotel, are not really internally displaced people. They could go back to their homes. They are migrants. They have chosen to move from Shahapur or Chamanpura or Asarva. They have chosen to, like Miraj, the person we began with, he has chosen to move to Bombay Hotel. He's not displaced by force. And so that issue comes up, and it's a very interesting, it seems to me, it's a very interesting legal issue, much bigger issue in other parts of the world, but an issue here as well. I wanted to close with a different issue entirely, and that's architecture. It's not directly related to what I've been talking about, but in the last few, maybe 2 months, this new book has come out called The Architecture of Hasmukh C. Patel, and it was prepared by Catherine Desai and by Bimal Patel at the School of Architecture. It's partly a tribute to Hasmukh Bhai, but it also is an evaluation of where architecture is going and has gone for the last 30 or 40 years and is likely to go in the future. It's not a direct issue in Ahmedabad at this moment, I don't think, but the School of Architecture is revising its curricula and revising its training programs. So the question of what it is that an architect and a planner has to be prepared to do to work effectively in the cities, in a contemporary city, is up for evaluation. And I wanted to read just a little bit here about Bimal's evaluation of his father's architecture, because I think it gives us a hint, a glimpse, maybe, of what may be happening just across the way at SEPT. Patel, that is Hasmukh Bhai, never articulated his social or political philosophy. Even now, when he looks back, he does not speak of his work in such terms. Yet when one views his body of work, it is clear that his practice was undergirded by a strong social commitment and guided by a clear mission, that of helping people in India's emerging middle class to invent a new modern cosmopolitan urban way of life. His practice was not a boutique pursuit, and his architecture was not meant to enhance, elite pleasures. Neither was architecture for him an indulgent, self-absorbed artistic pursuit. It was also not an instrument of state policy meant to aggrandize the state and to further its cultural or political missions. As the projects presented here, leave it at that. You get a picture of some of the values that Hasmukh Bhai had, and obviously in preparing this book, Bimal is certifying his agreement with that. He's not taking issue, quite the contrary. He's basically saying, these are some of the values that I also have, and one could expect that those values would then be even more enshrined in SEPT, which is one of the most important training schools for architects and planners in India. I forgot one issue because there are no books yet, but let me mention it before I completely conclude. I mentioned the work of French scholars. There are, and also an American, I think an Indian American named Zahir Jan Mohammed. There are a couple of people who have been working in Jaipura, and their work will be coming out at some point. Charlotte Thomas began working in Jaipura maybe 10 years ago. Maybe she's not that old, maybe 7 or 8 years ago, under the direction or with Christophe Jaffrelot. And she has produced a lot of anthropological views of what's going on there. And one of the points that she makes, and so does Zahir Jan Mohammed, is that while Joapura it's a difficult area, it is an area of poverty, people are beginning to work their way out of that. Ah, actually I had a video that I wanted to show, if I can call it up. I think it has disappeared, and it's late. But that you can find, if you look for it, videos on a man named Nadim Jafri, who runs a food store named Hardy Mart, right at the entrance to Joapura as you come in from the city going westward, and has multiplied those stores. I don't see it here now. There is some entrepreneurial growth in Joapura, and people are beginning to work their way back into the city economy. So there is a kind of resilience there. Zahir Jan Mohammed is a journalist in training, and he has come to Ahmedabad frequently and has begun to write about Bombay Hotel and Joapura and the changes that are going on there. Charlotte's work is, some of it's available in English. The book is not yet. She's still working on it in French, in a French publication. Zahir Jan Mohammed's is available in English in articles. And one of the comments that I remember his writing at one point, I didn't pick it out for today, is people came and said, show me all the disaster places in Joapura. And he said to them, don't you want to see any of the successes? Do you want to see any of the new schools, any of the new businesses? No, we're not interested. So he has a kind of an interest in the regrowth of Joapura as a functioning area of the city with connections to the city as a whole. To summarize, the areas of study for the city are many. There is inclusion and exclusion between Hindus and Muslims, between rich and poor, between old money and new money, between low-income housing and higher-income housing. I'm seeing here notes to myself that I forgot to talk about, but it's late and there's enough here. Changes in recovery, that even when disasters befall a city, as they have, people are resilient and they do come back with difficulties, but they do come back. There's a change in looking at the past. When historians and others mine the past, they look at the past to see what went on. They do so with different questions in mind. They do so to say, you know, how did migrants do in the past? What was the story before? What can we learn from that about the city of today? Ahmedabad is a city in the world with the whole neoliberal, a lot of parts of the city are this kind of neoliberal approach, but many are not. The Gandhian institutions in particular, Seva and its various subgroups, the Mahila Housing Trust, are very strong influence in this city that keep it from being a ruthless. I mean, the term of neoliberal often comes with the word ruthless. That isn't here, I don't think. And the development of the right to the city is more widely spread than perhaps elsewhere. People like Girish Patel keep the city attuned and keep the law courts and the law profession attuned to some of the needs of more poor people, much less privileged people. It is part of the world in legal issues, like this issue of internally displaced people. It is part of the world in terms of reaching out to the diaspora of Indians and Gujaratis and Ahmedabadis overseas. Non-resident Ahmedabadis overseas. We saw it when Prime Minister Modi made his trips to the United States, that he was very actively involved in trying to recruit maybe people and certainly direct investment from overseas communities to the city of Ahmedabad. And I closed with a final point on the architecture of the city and how it has been a little bit distinctive in being attuned to the needs of upper middle class people, but not to the needs of extravagance. At least that was the view of Hasmukhbhai Patel. So those are areas of directions of the study of the city, many of them historical, because that's what I do. Some I've left out, like historic preservation. I've written about these things elsewhere. But these are some things that are currently very much on my mind, and I hope that they will, at least some of them, be very much on your mind, too, because here you are in Ahmedabad. Thank you. And shall I take questions? Do you think there will be questions? Okay. Yes.
So, according to you, the displacement of the people from the riverfront to houses, good or not so good? So, what was it done to eradicate the problems of the people and the problems of the society, or just had a political motive?
What's the political motive?
Sir, like you told about BJP, Congress told that we will building 2,000 houses. Then finally, BJP came up that we'll build 50 lakhs or something houses, the figures you told. So I think that means I'm asking you whether it is having a political motive.
Well, I think, you know, I started out, thank you, it's a good question. And it deserves the best answer I can give it, which is that, you know, it really depends on your perspective. I think all of these things are true. I think that the goal of the people who moved, who emptied out the riverfront, was to create an area for the city. That visit that I made yesterday to the flower garden, I mean, it seems to me that there ought to be a place in a city where an exposition of that kind can take place. The riverfront is being used for a lot of very useful public functions. The city did not have, to my knowledge, that kind of public space before. It's now a city of 70 lakhs of people, 7 million people. It needs a space like that. So the second part is that the people living in the slums actually were claiming private property. I mean, they said, I live here, I want to be here. But they did make it difficult to access. I, because of who I am and what I do, I would walk through those slums sometimes and down to the river. But I mean, normally you wouldn't do something like that. So they really did block access to everybody else. They were given new homes. The original plan called for their relocation along the river. That didn't happen because money came in from the central government. And the places like the Ajit, you see them everywhere, this Ajit Mill complex in Vatva, there are a lot of them. They were moved there. That relocation was difficult for them. Would they be better off in those houses or in the slums? That's why I showed the film. I don't know. The early protests against that removal implied that they would simply be thrown out, which did not happen, and it implied that the riverfront would be used by international capital. That also didn't happen. And that's why I think you have to look at what happened in retrospect. So I think it seems to me that there are plenty of good reasons to have moved people, especially if they got new housing, but they weren't consulted, and they weren't helped to find new jobs and to recreate community. One of the great, I hear this over and over again from almost everyone I talk to about Ahmedabad, the greatest problem is the lack of communication. That people do things for and to other people without consulting them. That's a real problem. That's the best I can do. Are there students? Yeah, in the back. Because we can talk anytime. Oh, get up and scream.
I'm not able to comment on the location that I'm going to provide an example of, but there have been instances that we have heard about that these people who get relocated to supposedly a better place to stay eventually end up giving that place for rent to somebody else, and then they go back actually to their slums to stay because they feel that's how they've lived all their life, and a lot of times they don't find ways and means to earn a living in the new place. So any comments on that?
Sure. That didn't happen here. The people, parts of the film that I skipped over are of the people destroying their own homes because they're required to. It was quite clear that they were not to come back to the place they left, and that place was going to be completely vacated. So that didn't happen. Your term of better places is a real question, because what is said over and over again, in fact, in the film, in parts that I didn't show, Girish Patel says it quite clearly, that what people really need is a job. And when you move them from their job, even if you give them a better house, they're at a loss because they can't support themselves. So they oftentimes do move back, and they weren't interested in getting this new apartment. Now they have a financial asset. They own the house, they have access to it, they can get rent for it. And so they make a decision based on the situation of, I'd rather have the money from the rent and be closer to my job than have this new apartment. I didn't ask for it. I mean, it's not as if they said, oh, I want that new one. They were sent there and said, don't like it. If you put it one way, that they're given something and they don't appreciate it and they go back and they just make money out of it, it sounds awful. If you look at it from a financial perspective, they have been given an asset and they use that asset to improve their economic condition and they go back to work where they were. You're right, I mean, it didn't happen here at all in terms of moving back. I think some of the people, there's usually clauses in the contract that forbid them from renting, but they do. Yeah, it does happen. And those are the two. Again, it's perspectives. It depends on whether you want to condemn them or say they're shrewd. What would I do?
The minority communities, as well as single women and men who might be wanting to live in Ahmedabad and not getting spaces. I would like your views on it.
Well, I think that is true. One hears it all the time about minority communities not being able to rent or buy in majority areas. That's so commonly heard that I have every reason to believe it. And I've heard it from people who've been denied housing. I simply didn't hear it about single women or single men, but I certainly can believe it, and maybe we can talk later about it, because I'm unfamiliar. Maybe there are people who have done studies. Are any single people here who have been denied rentals because you were single and they feared what you would do? I'm seeing a few hands go up.
I'm not it. I've heard several examples.
But you're not it.
I'm
not surprised. I'm thinking whether I would rent my house anyhow in Philadelphia to a. Yes. One hears all the time in India of the problems of implementation. A couple of months ago, the Prime Minister announced demonetization. It apparently caused a few problems here and there across the country. The problems of implementation are immense, and it's important, if possible, to hold government officials accountable. I doubt very much that whatever the plan was called for giving people substandard housing that leaked and that watered it. But how to hold officials accountable, accountability is an enormous problem. I agree with you 100%. Accountability is an enormous problem. Somebody once told me that the laws that India passes are worthy of Nobel Prizes, but the implementation is a problem. I'm not sure. Does that answer? I mean, what am I? You get a bad house. It's a bad house. I'm sorry?
If somebody works for it, speaks for them, is there no way out of it? Because there are people working for them.
Yes, there are NGOs that work, and political parties sometimes too. Well, the solution at present, it's a problem, and there are people that are working to try to increase accountability in this society. And maybe some people in this room are attached to organizations that try to increase accountability. I'm sure that the administration of this university is interested in accountability within the university for its teachers, for its students. In Temple University, where I work, I'm held accountable to all kinds of standards. Enforcing accountability is a very big issue everywhere. Yeah.
I had this question that when we study a city, so how, from what perspective do we study a city? When we talk about city, then sometimes it is the people who play a major role, because without people, there is no society. And without society, the city won't be as alive as it is. And if we talk, view it from the point of architecture or infrastructure that is being built, then that is also very basic, because without that, people won't be able to survive. So from which perspective do we study the city? From people's perspective, keeping them in the center, or taking the architecture and infrastructure changes into mind?
What's your choice for you?
I'm just confusing anyone to do. Maybe a combination of both.
That's a question that each person has to answer for herself. I mean, that was the whole point of the early part of my lecture. Different people have seen it very differently. That's one of the things that students learn, hopefully, in the course of a college career, is to begin to make value judgments, their own value judgments. Not to have some professor, especially some professor from far away, say, this is what you ought to do with your life. That's for you to figure out. Are you a student here? Are you a faculty member here? Well, get to it. Yes.
So you mentioned Bimal Patel a couple of times, and he's also one of the city's leading architect and the head of SEPT University. Isn't that a major conflict of interest in how the narrative of the city flows?
I don't know whether it's a conflict of interest in the narrative. It's a possible conflict of interest in business. And my impression from talking to Bimal is he tries to be very aware of that and to keep separate his work at SEPT and his work at HCP. But I'm not, I really can't, I mean, potentially there's a very real conflict. But it's my impression from my knowledge of the man that he tries to stay away from that. I don't know there's a conflict in the interpretation of the city. What did you have in mind?
Academia is the space where activities are critiqued, and if the head of a major academic institution is so into the system, then how does that happen?
It's a very real problem in potential. I must say that, I mean, you're right, it's potentially a very big problem. I must say in Bimal's defense, he's a close friend, so I'm, you know, put on the spot. But actually, I was really quite impressed that at the last convocation, his guest of honor was Girish Patel. And Girish Patel, I don't know whether any of you were there, but Girish Patel, in his convocation address to SEPT, talked about how badly things had gone on the riverfront and how badly people were treated. And Bimal was sitting there on the stage with him as that carried on. So I think you're absolutely right. The potential is certainly there. There is a difference between critiquing and building, and the two have to be kept separately. You're right. What will happen in fact? I mean, again, you know, to some degree it depends on the personality. I can't help but keep thinking about Donald Trump in the United States, where there's no separation. There's no separation between anything. I mean, it depends. There are institutions and there are individuals, and you hope that the individuals are careful. But you're right. There's certainly a potential conflict. The two realms are different. Pankajbhai, you wanted to ask something long ago. You get two microphones.
Well, thank you.
It's terrific.
For two questions.
Yeah.
So I have two questions.
Okay, this first microphone.
Yeah, yeah. One is you didn't talk about, I know you mentioned it earlier, you didn't talk about the changing structure of industry around Ahmedabad.
and whether that has had any role to play in the way Ahmedabad has evolved vis-a-vis other large emerging cities in the country. And the second is, you, I think, very nicely laid out the extremes that we see in the city on a variety of different dimensions, you know, whether it is the economics, or whether it is social engagement or other things. Where is this middle ground for a city like Ahmedabad?
Oh.
What is the middle ground that, or the common ground that now the city must walk going forward?
Your first question, I haven't studied industry. I haven't studied industry very much. I did in the old, when I first came here, I studied the textile mills. That was really the first subject of my studies of Ahmedabad. There were textile mills there to study, lots of them, and entrepreneurs. I haven't studied industry very much, and you know from a private conversation that we had that I'm very interested in the effect of Sanand on Ahmedabad. What's the relationship between the state government and the city government and the regional government, and in particular, what was the role of Chief Minister Mody, who brought the nano plant to Sanand and that area? Have some of you ridden around Sanand? Have you driven around there or gone around there? It's an immense area with immense number. I commend it to you. I mean, go around there. And it's just an immense area with new industries growing up. I have not studied it. People tell me of studies that are being done on the villages around Sanand and how the villages are changing things. I think there have been studies of the work of people who sold their land and are now trying to find jobs in Sanand, even though apparently they have enough money. I haven't studied it, but surely the industrial base makes a huge difference. I have gone into some of the larger plants, Xylus, Cadila, the big pharmaceuticals and chemical plants, and it's very striking at how few people they employ. I mean, this issue of lack of non-jobs is obvious. You walk into the plant, then you walk around, and you look, there aren't many. I haven't studied it, but that is a problem. It is both of, you know, it's good in the sense of money is there. It's not so good in that there aren't jobs. And with Sanand, the idea of building a whole new hub of economic development is a very fascinating idea, and it is happening. I don't know all the implications. It's a huge subject. And if anybody wants to work on it, let me know, because I want to hear what you're doing. The second question about how to find the middle ground is, I guess, the academic word for it is dialectical. I mean, people have to engage in discussing it. If issues aren't brought out, then they don't get talked about at all. So it's really up to different groups to represent themselves. You know, if I'm not for myself, who will be? And the middle ground comes from that interplay, and not everybody's going to be happy all the time. But again, like the question about how do you choose your values, it's a similar question in a way. They come out of the discussions. In my belief, in my value system, in my thinking, the answers don't come from outside saying, I know what's best for everybody. Oh, that kind of master planning. I think it comes from people honestly trying to work out what each one needs, and nobody is satisfied, but, you know, the things go on. One last thought about this. I once talked to a friend of mine in the States who's a very good lawyer about Gandhian unions. And I said, you know, the Gandhians argue that why have a strike? Sooner or later, the strike will be resolved. You don't want a strike that ends the industry. It will happen. Why don't they just sit down and do it from the beginning? Why go through all of the agony and the turmoil? And my friend said, you don't understand human nature. That's the way things are. People fight, and at the end of the fight, they reach a resolution. I think he was right. There is one more hand, and then I suppose we should, yeah, Rita? Oh, it's not?
Yeah. Thank you so much for that very, very comprehensive talk, and there were books that I hadn't heard about.
And so even some that aren't published yet.
Yeah. Yeah,
there you go.
And you began by talk, Howard, by situating yourself in the discipline of history. And as a historian, you ask questions of a specific nature. I was sort of curious to know that in this long engagement that you've had with the city of Ahmedabad, and as someone who situates himself in this specific discipline, whether at the end of these many years and after having seen the many other perspectives that come from disciplines other than yours, whether you have felt that there might be lenses and prisms which are not available to history, and that they might be available to people who come from, let's say, literature or culture studies or anthropology, and whether you have found it necessary sometimes to revisit without compromising on some of the central ways by which you would be asking questions, to see whether there are forms of unraveling the non-verbal, the unseen, the unspoken, and whether those have come to you from other forms of learning. And if you could sort of comment on that. Yeah.
Well, I think that history is a comprehensive discipline. I think that Pankaj Bhai was saying that in his introduction, that it is in the nature of history to, you know, we vacuum up information. We read the landscape. We read the poetry. We see what's here. I know that you're currently interested in food and other aspects of culture. That may be a little more difficult. But it's in the nature of the study of history always to look at what anthropologists have to say, what economists have to say, what architects have built, what poets have written. Uma Shankar wrote a poem that was titled Chin Bin Chung, you know, I'm shattered. And the title alone runs through my mind frequently wherever I am. So there are elements in the culture, of course. I don't see that as a question. I mean, I see it as a question, but I don't see that as an issue. That's what historians do. And you know, you visit battlefields, you visit places, you visit riverfronts, you visit religious festivals, you see what's going on, and to the extent that you can see how it worked out in the past, you do that. I could go on, but one of my professors, Barney Cohn at the University of Chicago, wrote about a historian among the anthropologists and an anthropologist among the historians. I mean, that's what you do. You try to use his anthropological tools. How do people live in the past? And then you look at the past in terms of how the things developed. Does that answer your question? Okay, we'll talk more. You said you were going to invite me to breakfast. So okay. Thank you.
University with.
Thank you.
You virtually are a citizen of Ahmedabad, but we would like to make you a part of Ahmedabad University.
Thank you very much.
Can I take this opportunity also to thank all of you, and of course our chair, Professor Spodek, for a brilliant talk that we've had this morning. And as I was listening to him, and as at the end Rita tried to raise the questions, I thought, is he a historian? He's talking from various perspectives. I mean, he could be an economist, he could be talking from the social cultural point of view, he is talking from the political point of view. So it's not a historical perspective that we've got, but we've got diverse perspectives. And then, as he rightly answered at the end, that a historian sort of embraces diverse disciplines, diverse perspectives, and brings them all to bear upon developing insights that they create for us. And we are very grateful to you for spending a lifetime of effort on studying the city and bringing us insights and showing us what we, the residents of this city, have never seen. Thank you so much. Thank you all for being with us today.